3D prints are weak. That's why in this video, I'll show you how to make 3D prints stronger by inserting hardware into them while printing. From simple hacks like filling hollow parts with PU foam to adding carbon fiber rods for super high stiffness. There's something for everyone from beginner to pro. So let's dive right into it, here at JanTec Engineering. Thanks to Fanttik for sponsoring part of this video. Also, shout out to Prusa Research for sponsoring my new studio. It helps me create all these videos without having to commute multiple hours every day. If you've been following this channel, you know I'm a little obsessed with making 3D prints stronger. I've tested all kinds of engineering filaments, showed cat tricks, and even tried injecting molten filament into the infill. Today, I want to take a different approach. Instead of only tweaking settings and materials, we're going to embed hardware directly into our prints to make them stronger, stiffer, heavier, or even watertight. I tried a lot of different things for this video. Some are super simple and beginner friendly, others need a bit more skills or equipment. Just so we're on the same page. The idea is to incorporate hardware, basically anything that isn't molten filament, into the part while it's being printed. And the cool thing is, technically, all of this comes down to one single command in the slicer, M601. That command tells the printer, pause the print before printing this layer and wait until the user hits continue on the display. In the slicer, you just move the slider to the height where you want to add your hardware. Important detail, the printer pauses before the selected layer. So if you want to drop a magnet into this hole, you add the pause at the layer where the printer starts closing that hole with the overhang. And I guess that's everything we need to know to start putting random stuff into our 3D prints. Let's start easy. Sometimes you actually want a part to be heavy. Doorstops, counterweights, camera bases, and so on are good examples. One could simply increase the infill density, but that comes with high costs. More print time, more filament, more energy consumption. So why not print with 0% infill and add weight through cheaper materials? You can fill pretty much anything. Sand, metal balls, failed prints you've chopped up, AMS poop, and so on. Whatever you have lying around. For example, I printed this statue completely hollow and then filled it with sand during a print pause. As a reference, I also made one without filling. As you can see, the sand version is much heavier. You can even calculate it in advance using the density of the sand and the approximate volume of your object. The workflow is simple. In the slicer, set your infill to 0% and add a pause at the right layer. The printer stops, you pour in your sand or drop in your weights, hit continue and it gets sealed up. Just make sure to disable your part cooling fan after the pause, otherwise it might blow sand all over your printer. And this is a good opportunity to mention one of my new favorite slicer tools, height range modifiers. With height range modifiers, you can tell the slicer to use different settings for different Z heights. So, for example, you can make the walls around the cavity thicker, then print a couple of full layers to seal it up and continue with regular infill. I've been using this more and more because you can really fine-tune specific zones of a part instead of changing everything globally. Sand and metal are great if you want to add mass. But what if you want the opposite? Let's say we want our part to be solid, lightweight, and maybe even watertight. That's where PU foams come in. I've been thinking about this idea for a while. Print a hollow shell and then inject expanding foam into it. While I was working on this video, I actually stumbled across a super detailed test and a Hackaday article on exactly that topic. I'll link them below if you want to take a look at the deep dive data. The basic idea is simple. You print a mostly hollow part with a few access holes. After printing, you inject PU foam into one of the holes. The foam expands inside, fills the internal volume and then hardens. This leads to a part that's more rigid than just the empty shell, still relatively lightweight, and depending on the design, even watertight. For a demo, I made such a block, printed with 0% infill and no foam or such. The walls bend as expected, it's really weak. For my second version, I designed a hole and two vents into it. I then filled it with PU foam from the hardware store. It's a bit messy, but once the foam hardened, I was able to cut off the excess and it feels solid while being relatively lightweight. It even passed the hammer test, making it feel like it's almost indestructible, especially when you remember that the printer basically only printed a thin plastic shell. Now let's finally get to actually improving a part's strength. When walking through hardware stores, I saw a lot of interesting things that could be embedded into 3D prints. Threaded rods, aluminium profiles, steel pins, wire grids, all standard parts, super accessible and stronger than printed plastic. One of the biggest challenges in FDM 3D printing is the layer adhesion. No matter how you orient your part, there's always a weak spot in the Z direction where the layers can break apart. And in some designs, you end up with tiny cross sections that snap easily. To demonstrate this, I made a simple bone-shaped sample. In the middle, there's a thin section that becomes the obvious weak spot, especially if you print it standing up. In CAD, I then took the same model and cut a negative volume that perfectly fits a long metric screw. That could also be a rod, a tube, whatever straight metal piece you have lying around. I printed two versions, one completely normal with regular infill and no hardware inside, and one with the internal channel and a print pause. I dropped the screw into the cavity, fixed it into place with my Fanttik screwdriver, hit continue, and the printer finished the bone. The regular part snapped very easily right at the finished cross-section, as expected. The reinforced part, on the other hand, was completely different. I had to apply a lot more force, and when it finally did break, it didn't fail in the middle where I added the screw. It broke out in a completely different area above the screw where there was no reinforcement. That's a good sign. It means that the reinforcement zone was no longer the weak point and it works exactly as intended. By the way, if you like this kind of videos, I'd really appreciate it if you subscribe to my channel. So far, only a small percentage of my viewers are subscribed and it would really help me out. Thanks a lot. Of course, you're not limited to just one screw in the middle of a test bone. You can integrate basically anything you have lying around. I recently dropped the washer into a part so the force from a tightening screw gets spread over a larger area instead of crushing the plastic. You can embed little steel angles into corners, push in a metal grid, or place thin sheet metal inside a flat part to stop them from bending. You can get really creative with this, and I think it's super fun. To get even more advanced, I ordered some carbon. Before we get to implementing these carbon rods into our 3D prints, a quick message from today's sponsor, Fanttik. Their tools are super useful for 3D printing and making. For finishing prints, I use the Fanttik F2 Master. It's cordless, pen-sized and comes with 35 different accessories that can be used for grinding, polishing, drilling, carving and more. There are 5 speed settings up to 25,000 RPM. The housing is made from aluminium and it's water and dust proof, so you can wipe off dust in seconds. For 3D printer assemblies and repairs, I use the Fanttik Eron Max Precision Screwdriver. It also comes in a compact metal case that holds the driver, 50 S2 metal precision bits and a few extra tools. It charges via USB-C and a 350 mAh battery is rated for over 2 hours of continuous work, making it ideal for drones, computers, phones, watches and, of course, 3D printers. If you solder, also check out the T1 Max in the description. Links and discounts for all 3 products are in the description. Using them helps the channel at no extra cost to you. Thanks to Fanttik for making this test possible. Now back to the video. I recently went to Formnext in Frankfurt and saw a lot of cool 3D printers, filaments and accessories. One booth that caught my attention was FiberSeek with their new FiberSeeker 3, a desktop 3D printer that lays continuous fibers into the printed part. Even though I'm still a bit skeptical about the whole project and the approach, the concept is super interesting. They had a bunch of printed parts at the booth and those things were insanely stiff. By hand, I wasn't able to bend it. That got me thinking, could we add continuous carbon fiber strength without the need to buy a whole new 3D printer? While digging into that idea, I came across carbon fiber rods. These are pre-made rods or strips that you can buy in all kinds of shapes and sizes. They are made from long carbon fibers in an epoxy, with the fibers mostly running along the length of the rod. According to the data sheets, you'll often find fiber volume fractions above 60%. And honestly, they are way cheaper than I expected. There are dedicated local shops that sell carbon rods, but you can also find plenty of options on eBay and Amazon. I'll put some links in the description if you want to check out the rods I used. After my carbon order finally arrived, I modeled my first test part, a simple bending beam that I usually use for my 3-point bending test with inlays for the carbon fiber. I cut it to size to insert it into the 3D print. Don't forget to wear proper safety equipment when working with fiber materials. As expected, the fiber reinforced sample got a lot stiffer. It's really hard to bend it by hand. I tested it with my 3-point bending experiment. Here you can see a comparison of different filaments and the carbon reinforced version in terms of bending modulus. In a real application, you can use carbon rods to stiffen specific areas of your part. You can even make them slide in so you don't have to deal with the print pores. I also got myself such a 10mm carbon tube that I will use for a future project. My test print with a slide in worked really nicely, improving part strength and stiffness without adding a lot of weight. What do you think about adding carbon fiber rods into 3D prints? Let me know in the comments. For the last step, I machined a custom bracket from aluminium. This method is definitely more for professionals because you need extra equipment, in this case a CNC machine that can cut aluminium. I recently tested the Macara Cavera Air and was surprised by its quality. In the meantime, they introduced the Macara Z1, a really capable yet affordable mini CNC marketed as a 3D printer companion. This could enable more people to get into CNC machining at home. For my tensile testing machine, I needed a bracket that holds the load cell, lead screw nuts and cables. It should be as stiff as possible, so I drew an inlay for the holder that I machined from aluminium on my Cavera Air. You can apply the same principle to all kinds of things. Mounts, brackets, clamps, anything that needs extra strength or metal parts in certain areas. In fact, you can even 3D print the insert parts separately and then embed them during a print pause, just like we did with screws and carbon rods. Christopher Helmke showed a neat example of this where he printed the geometry in two pieces, assembled them into the main print during a pause and then had the printer fuse everything together. I just didn't want to leave that unmentioned because it's a clever workaround if you don't have a multi-material printer but still want to combine materials with different properties. That's it for the things I tried to make 3D print stronger. If you have other tricks or ideas in mind, feel free to share them in the comments. I read all of them and I'm really curious about your thoughts. I really like the whole concept of embedding hardware into 3D prints. The possibilities are basically endless. DigiKey, for example, published an article where they integrated an LED strip into a 3D print. As always, thanks to my channel members for supporting what I do. If you want to support the channel free of charge, consider subscribing and check out the affiliate links and discount codes in the video description. Thanks for watching and see you next time here at JanTec Engineering.